Wait, like, go! Wait, not yet!
We need a plan. We need a plan.
Wait.
A good plan, a very good plan.
We need to start with the preparations. It's a big plan. We will proceed step by step, okay?
We need a very good...
The history will change. Maps, social structures, economic balance, a new system, a new world, a new...
Plan.
Wait, not yet!
Good boy, a very good boy.
We need someone with power, faithful to us and trusted by them.
Wait, not yet!
A good boy, a brave boy, a strong boy, a bit insane. As dangerous as we need, a flawless link.
Fearless, heartless, loveless, faultless.
A flawless link in chain.
One of them. He will turn into a beast and ravage his country in an unstoppable vortex of fear and destruction. We just need to keep him in line long enough,
and
then we can finish our work.
One of
we will keep
them
him in line, and then he will go off on time.
Them
not sooner,
and
not later.
Wait, not yet!
Conditions, circumstances, conjuncture, expectations,
needs,
preparations,
strategy,
statistics. We create enemies.
We need fear. We need hate.
Feel the opposition. Position.
We need a reason.
We proceed
step by step.
chess, my dear. It's chess. It's chess that we play. It's a business, my dear. It's a business we make. We must sell and sell and sell. That makes the world worse than hell.
Step by step by step by step by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Calculated, calibrated.
Step by step by step by step by.
It's all modulation, moderation, renovation, adaptation, accumulation. Criminalization, commercialization, crystallization, criminalization, authorization. Stabilization, specialization, clarification, glorification. Polarization, dramatization, traumatization, industrialization, nationalization, rationalization. It's a civilization. Repression, capitalization. It's a Negro.
We can sell the craziest lies for a fortune of lies. Eventually, our truth will be determined. Keep them continually busy. Sensations, TV shows, disrupt them, numb them, film and show, and let them die. Create news. Manipulate them, shock them, comfort them. That's what they want.
ABC,
they're ready to ignore us all anyway. Keep them busy and make them forget everything. That's very important.
USAKPK.
Every bomb that explodes is a return on our investment. Death converts the cash, and war generates us revenues. Step by step. Step by step. Step by step. Step by step. Step by step.
STEPBCNNEUSAKPKKUS.
Step by step. Step by step. Step by step.
Thank you for knowing, for not knowing. Thank you for believing. Thank you for being thankful. Whatever God gives and takes, your giant faith and boundless strength. Thank you for being so easily polarized, radicalized. Thank you for being vulnerable, useful, usable. Thank you for forgetting from one day to the next, and going on as if nothing had happened. Thank you for being helpless and voiceless. Thank you for being poor, being rich, hopeless, honest, dishonest. Thank you. Thank you for being you. Thank you for fighting whenever we need. Thank you for your unlimited capacity for conflict with each other. Thank you for playing the game. Thank you for losing your parks, gardens, garden tables, handmade tablecloths, pajamas, combs, slippers. Thank you for losing your houses, your books, letters, pens, the posters on your walls, postcards, baby bottles, teaspoons, trash bins, carpets, your wedding presents, baskets, apples, toys, your joy, comfort, trust, pride. Thank you. Thank you so much for losing your arms, losing your legs, your heads, your hearts, your minds, your bones, your fingers. Thank you so much for losing your mothers, fathers, little daughters, sons, neighbors, your uncles, cousins, your jobs, houses, hospitals, roads, mosques, schools, past, future, your identity, color, face, pride. Thank you for dying. You are the guarantee of our wealth and comfort. It's all thanks to you. Thank you for your appearance in the darkness, absence in the light. Thank you.
Thank you. to the Middle East report, where we always try to combine politics with art. And this year, we have the opportunity to ask artists to make four special mini operas, especially for the Middle East report. And tonight, Selim Doğru made the opera Walking in Silence. Thank you, Selim. Can you start with introducing the cast so we can give them a big round of applause?
Yes. Actually, it is not really a performance to give an applause, but we need to give the names. That's why. Gabriel Arbelau. Yes. Marijn Alper. Brandt. Riyad Wereld Music Corps. Francis. Brian. Sharon. Imra. And Robert.
And Selim Doğru, of course. Thank you. Well, Selim, I have one. I think I have one question for you. You knew tonight was about Turkey.
Yes.
What made you decide to tell this story?
Because, you know, what happens in the Middle East, I don't see it as a Turkish part or Syrian problem or Iraq problem. It is actually one whole thing, and everything is connected to each other, especially since 2003, from the Iraq war. It is called war, but for me it is something else. But when America decided to attack Iraq and kill thousands of people, from that moment until now, whatever happens in Turkey, in Syria, in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in all the countries in Middle East, for me it is one whole thing. That's why I cannot take the situation at the moment, what's happening in Turkey, out of the context. That's why I tried to put actually the whole view on the piece and try to show that it's all connected to each other.
Thank you very much. Selim Doğru, Walking in Silence. And while the cast is taking a seat, I would like to say welcome to the Middle East Report, as I already said. My name is Myrthe Vreese, and I'm the presenter of tonight, together with my co-host Bahram Sadeghi. You don't have to applaud, he still has to prove himself. For those of you who are new to the Middle East Report, welcome everyone, have a seat, also the latecomers. We started this program more than 3 years ago. The war in Syria was already going on for a year, and tens of thousands of Syrians were already on the run, fleeing within Syria, fleeing to neighboring countries like Lebanon, Jordan, and Turkey, of course. But there was very little interest, actually, from the West into the conflict, and also within Dutch media. So we decided we want to make a program to address what was going on. Well, then very soon Syria became headlines. And then we decided to continue with the Middle East Report and to try to provide background information, in-depth analysis, and not only look at Syria, but look at the bigger picture. So we discussed Lebanon, ISIS, of course, the Kurdish question, and but every year we make a program whether or not the West should intervene in Syria or not. But tonight we're going to talk about Turkey, a country that is on the news, I think, every night now. It seems the discourse has really changed about Turkey. Turkey is no longer framed as the country that can bridge the Middle East with the Europe, or the country where Western democratic values can coexist with Islamic culture. Turkey seems to be in a crisis right now, both domestically and internationally. There are terrorist attacks, there's a violent war in the East, there's an influx of 2.5 million refugees, there's the curtailing of human rights and freedom of the press. And also on an international scale, it seems like Turkey now has positioned itself as a country surrounded by enemies. And yesterday I read an article by, I think, a very good Turkish writer. Her name is Elif Shafak. And she said, it is demoralizing to see the ideological shift from being a country that aspires to be an EU member to a country that sees Saudi Arabia as its only ally. Whether you agree with that is up to you, but I thought it was an interesting remark. So, of course, we cannot cover all these issues and subjects in the remaining an hour and a half. We're going to do our best, but what we're going to discuss is, of course, the violence in the East and also the consequences of the refugee crisis domestically for Turkey as well as for Turkey and EU relations. We're going to discuss that with a member of the European Parliament, Kati Piri. We're going to have, if it's working, you never know, but we hope, a Skype conversation with journalist Frederik Geerling about freedom of the press, especially the current developments. And we have, we're going to start that later, we have a keynote lecture by Karabekir Akkoyunlu. Oh, I tried. Akkoyunlu. He was here 3 years ago to talk about Turkey. He's now here again about what's going on in Turkey, and especially whether this or not is all traced back to the aspirations of one man, Tayyip Erdoğan. But first, we always like to know short who we have in the audience and what your knowledge of Turkey is right now. So I give the floor to my colleague, Baram Sadeghi.
Ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to share some facts and figures about Turkey, especially for non-Turkish people here. But are there any people, are any Turks here, any Turkish people? Yeah, please allow me. Yeah. Oh, about half of the audience are Turkish. One more time, please, to see some. Okay. Can I ask you, what makes you Turk? Are you born in Turkey, born in Holland?
I was born in Istanbul.
And now you live in Holland?
I do.
And what makes you... Do you have a still Turkish nationality, Turkish passport?
I do. I am still a Turkish citizen.
Thank you very much. So you probably know how big Turkey is, how many people living over there, and especially this borderline between Turkey and Syria, which these days is very important. But for the other people like me, I am born in Iran. I know a little bit of this region, but believe it or not, till 3 weeks ago, I couldn't say how many people are actually living in Turkey, how big is Turkey. Maybe some Dutch people or not Turkish people, just to check how well informed we are. Can I ask you?
Yes.
Yeah, how many people are living in, how many inhabitants in Turkey, population?
Oh my God, that's a good question.
Give me just a guess.
Can someone help me?
No, just
80 million?
80 million, wow. Thank you, neighbor. Thank you. So, exactly. There are 79.6 million people in Turkey. And as you probably know, Turkey, but almost all Turkey, all people are Muslims. Only about 0.2% of Turkey are not Muslims, they are mostly Christian and Jewish. And Turkey is made up, about 30% of Turkish population is made up by ethnic minorities. We probably all have heard about the Arab minorities, Azerbaijanis and Roma, but the largest minority, ethnic minority of Turkey, and one of the issues which we'll talk about later are the Kurds, of course, the Kurdish people. And about 12 to 14 million Kurdish people living in Turkey. But if you ask the Kurdish people themselves, they say they are about 16 to 20 million. And Turkey is a very big country. If they join the European Union, they will be the biggest country in Europe. And it's about 20 times bigger than Holland. It's about 800,000 square kilometers. And maybe we can have a picture of the border between Turkey and Syria, which we are. So that's the red line. That's a very important issue for later, which we are talking about. And the other parts you can see about Iraq. And this borderline is about 800 kilometers. It's about twice as the coastline of Holland. And when we are talking about the refugees, because that will be one of the issues later on. There are about 2.0 million refugees from Syria in Turkey. To compare it with other countries, about 1.5 million in Lebanon, Germany about half a million, and Do we have any idea about Holland? How many Syrian refugees in Holland? Can someone give me 40,000, someone said? Yeah, it's not bad. Yeah, 30,000. Yeah, thank you very much. So, but in Turkey, as I said, 2.6 million. And to the main title of the evening, Erdoğan. As you probably all know, he was the mayor of Istanbul 4 years, and he founded his own party, AKP, in 2001. And during the elections in 2002, 2007, and 2011, they won the elections, general elections victories. And he has been prime minister of Turkey from 2003 till 2014. And ever since that day, in 2014, he's now the president. And finally, for fact and figures, Sultan. What does it mean, a Sultan? And it's whether the sovereign of an Islamic country, any of the former sovereigns of Turkey, or the last option, an absolute ruler or a despot. So these are the facts and figures which are maybe important for this evening. Mirti.
Yes, and with this background information, I would like to introduce you to, as I already said, our keynote speaker, Karabekir Akkoyunlu. Please take a stand. Kara, as I am allowed to say, is assistant professor of modern Turkey at the Center for Southeast European Studies at the University of Graz in Austria. He completed his PhD in comparative politics at the London School of Economics on the transformation of hybrid regimes in Turkey and Iran. And he has published extensively on Turkish politics, society and foreign affairs on numerous forums and magazines. And he will give a lecture on the recent political developments in Turkey. Thank you, Kara, for being here.
Thank you very much. Thank you for this very kind invitation, and welcome to you all. It's my second privilege to be here in the Balie to speak. Thank you. The first time was, as Misa said, was in 2012, actually, already almost 4 years ago, when we were talking about a very different Turkey in also a very different geography. Now, first of all, I would like to say that less than a lecture, I would like to make this as a, you know, a fairly informal conversation, even though some of the subjects that I'm going to cover are quite grim and serious. There is indeed something rotten in the state of Turkey, as not Shakespeare, but Slavoj Žižek recently said. Until recently, a country that was supposed to be a model to the wide region and an Islamic democracy, a Muslim democracy, now looks more and more in throes of crisis, trouble, and autocracy. That turn for some in the outside has come very, very quickly. For others inside, this has been in the making for quite some time. And in fact, when we came here in 2012 to talk about the possibility of Turkish model, about which there was a lot of excitement, we tried to also emphasize that there is something going on inside Turkey that will probably prevent it from not only be a model for the outside world, but internally. Because what makes Turkey a model, potentially, is the state of its democracy, and that was in deterioration. Now, we talk about Turkey today, about the Kurdish civil war that's going on, that's restarted, unfortunately, again, in a very, very vicious way. We talk about academics who are being investigated and labeled as traitors for signing a peace petition, about journalists who are facing jail for their reporting, about citizens in their thousands who are being taken to court for insulting the president of the republic. Now, this is a very grim picture wherever you look from it, and in fact, nobody denies that it's a grim picture. Everybody just puts the blame on somebody else. Now, how do I make this work? Okay, so I wanted to ask, to begin with, what's new about Turkey's new regime? But I first want to talk about what is this new regime. In fact, when we try to understand and how it transformed, when a lot of people are asking this question in the West, in Turkey, around the world, because Turkey is a country that matters, increasingly so, because it's at the intersection of various neighborhoods, Europe and the Middle East, which are both, in their own ways, in crisis at the moment. So these crises are reflected in Turkey and Turkey reflects them back. So it's an important question. But what's happening in Turkey? Something is rotten in the state of Turkey. And who is or what is responsible for it? Now, the answer you would find in a lot of places, and I guess the question that we're asked to deal with in this panel, in this session, is can we bring it down to the ambition of one man? Former Prime Minister, now President, Recep Tayyip Erdoğan, is he the Sultan of Turkey? Now, this is a very popular and, in fact, a quite enticing conceptualization, right? It doesn't only talk about the pursuit, very ambitious pursuit of power by one man in a ruthless manner, but it also talks about, conceptualizes this country, Turkey. If you're looking from the West, going from the West to the East, quite actually an Orientalist perception, I would say. From democracy, from rationality, human rights, to something that pre-modern, as we think of, you know, in the West, of the Ottoman Empire, often. So it has a lot of elements that it contains that are quite easily referenced by people. You know, when you say the Sultan of Turkey, all of you probably think of something, not the same thing, but nonetheless, it has a communicable aspect to it. Therefore, you see in press reports, in mainstream headlines in the West, but also in the East, a lot of these titles: Erdoğan, the new Sultan of Turkey. Is it the Sultan of Turkey? Does he see himself as a 21st century Sultan of Turkey? The Greeks ask this question, as do the Iranians, the Dutch, the Germans. But not only these, the Turks themselves as well. From different perspectives, of course. It is not, it would not be wrong to say, by the way, I think some of the pictures have shifted a bit, to say that some of the supporters of this very popular, very charismatic, and very divisive man like to see him as a sultan. You'll see above a banner unfurled that says, Recep Tayyip Erdoğan, the last sultan of the Ottomans, at one of the rallies in 2009. Another figure that I found in the internet among a Facebook group that is a devout follower of Erdoğan, putting him at the head of the Ottoman armies against the Crusaders, which is the Crusader army is headed by the head of the main opposition party, Kemal Kılıçdaroğlu, on the right. But also the opponents of the president take upon this conceptualization, the Sultan, right? On the left, you will see a caricature on a very ardently critical newspaper, nationalist, Sözcü newspaper, with Erdoğan cutting off the head of the Twitter bird and dressed up as a Sultan. And we can even say that His Majesty does not always take steps away from this depiction. There are, in fact, a lot of symbolisms that do suggest to us that maybe some of this, you know, conception of this returning Ottoman Empire, of the returning the rule and charisma of the Sultan, appeals to him. He likes it. And the pomp and the palace and the statements do seem to reflect that. There you can see him saying that, Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdoğan, I want to be like the Queen of the United Kingdom. Is this, as an academic, I asked whether this is an appropriate analytical framework to bring everything down to analyze Turkey. And I have to say that I have troubles. I have problems with it. I have problems with it on three different levels. First of all, it is the idea that we put an extreme emphasis, despite the fact that he is larger than life and has, with his own decisions at critical junctures and his quite ruthless pursuit of power, determined the course of Turkey over the last decade even more. There is also an aspect in among us who are watching Turkey of turning this into a bit of a celebrity matter, of being very much caught up in the persona, and therefore losing sight of the structural dynamics that actually make a person like Erdoğan who he is and bring him to where he is. And also the question of Erdoğan as the Sultan of Turkey probably means that we are focusing quite a lot on Turkey, taking it apart and juxtaposing its present with its past. But maybe we should remember that we're talking about what's happening in Turkey at a time when our world, our political spectrum is dominated by these figures. I mean, this is the period of the liberal crisis, the liberal consensus in Europe, in the West, from Russia to the Balkans to Central and Western Europe, all the way to the United States, which Trump wants to make great again, is under significant threat. Right-wing populisms, anti-liberal and illiberal governments are on the rise. So when we're talking about the personality of Erdoğan, or Erdoğan himself, and his transformation, we should keep that in mind. And we should not forget that it was the same person 10 years ago who was praised in the Western press as the Muslim reformer, 5 years ago the model for the Arab world. Has Erdoğan changed? Have our views of him changed? Or has the world changed? Probably all three of them. So we need to have a perspective that combines all three as well. Finally, I have a problem with the notion of Sultan. Thank you for giving the definition for it. I'm happy that we've laid it out. But I have a problem with it because I think it is historically unfair to the Ottoman Empire. Now, I say this, but I have to put a disclaimer. I am not in any way a neo-Ottomanist or do not have a nostalgia for Turkey's imperial glory. I am from Turkey, by the way. But I have studied history, and I'm quite interested in the structures of the Ottoman Empire, and this juxtaposition of the current regime of Turkey with the Ottoman Empire strikes me as inaccurate. When we talk about the Ottoman Empire, we talk about a monarchy, a dynasty that survived for 600 years, 36 sultans, ruled at its height over three continents that included, and in today's standards, or any standard, an impossible diversity of languages, ethnicities, cultures, religions, what have you. Now, if we think, as many of us might do, even in Turkey and outside, that this was possible only through the absolute power of the Sultan, the personalized rule of the Sultan, we may be missing the point a little bit. The Ottoman Empire's success for its longevity and its ability to maintain these different diversities together was not due to the absolute rulership of a sultan, which actually was quite restrained after a certain while, but rather the existence of institutions, of a bureaucracy that limited the powers of the sultan, of a legal framework that was actually established and was respected and worked for centuries until it got really messed up towards the end. And an administrative formula which, despite the theoretical hierarchy of the system, actually gave impressive autonomy to different regions, different ethnicities, well, actually not ethnicities, different religions, different trade groups, and other groups as well. So, this is not what's happening in Turkey. In Turkey, not only under Erdoğan, but of course over the last century, even more so, the issue we have is one of centralization. Extreme centralization, where one person's or one government's will is imposed upon the entirety of the nation. Of course, that's the nation state we're talking about. That is a centralized nation state, which the Ottoman Empire was not. And of course, we're also talking about today the destruction of institutions, the personalization of power at the expense of bureaucracy. So the Ottoman Empire framework is historically problematic, and I would urge you to take it with a grain of salt. I also wanted to add that the Ottoman sultans left quite a good panorama of Istanbul, which is not to say the same thing with its, that is happening in it. Yeah. And here's the part that I would like to bring especially to our Dutch and European audience. I think when we look at the current predicament of the Turkish regime, the Turkish government, we'll realize that actually some of its basic tenets that are emerging are quite modern and quite familiar to those who are themselves familiar with the history of Europe, the recent history of Europe. Now, it is a very fluid transition, but if we wanted to take a snapshot of the Turkish regime, the regime that is in place and is evolving in Turkey today, what kind of characteristics would we write down? Now, I thought of a few, and I came up with these. There's an idiosyncratic belief system. It combines very contradictory, very peculiar notions. Universalism of Islamism, specificities of Turkish nationalism, anti-Westernism, but working with the West, anti-capitalism, but neoliberalism. And this is constantly changing. Okay, so there is not a pinpointed ideology in play, which is, of course, quite interesting. Anti-liberalism and anti-intellectualism increasingly. If you have, of course, an intellectual strand, you could bring apart this idiosyncratic belief system, but it is not permitted, less and less so. There is an open discourse of anti-liberalism, which regards with regards to its individualism, but also liberal rights that are, you know, enshrined in Turkey's own constitution as well. Selective populism, meaning there is not the individual, not the plurality, but a mass of people on whose behalf the leader speaks. And of course, there are those that are outside of it. So it's a selective populism. There's an obsession with a plot. Something is always happening against Turkey. Everybody is against Turkey. And there are enemies inside and outside. And those enemies differ from the Kurds to the Alevis, if they're against the government, the atheists, the communists, all the way to the outside, or the other Islamists who were once friends and no longer allies with the government, and so on and so forth. The United States, Russia, Iran, Syria, there is an obsession with the existence of a plot. Disagreement is treason. This is increasingly the case in Turkey, especially within the government. Disagreement, even if you're one of the founders of the Justice and Development Party, the ruling party of Turkey, if you criticize openly the government's path, you will be labeled a traitor. It is increasingly difficult in this anti-intellectual environment to have a debate, a constructive debate. It's a race to the bottom, in a sense. Newspeak, those who are familiar with 1984 will know what newspeak is, to create concepts that are actually quite opposite to their meanings. The current military operation that is so destructive in the Kurdish provinces are called peace operations. You saw pictures of Cizre, a city that has been utterly destroyed by the fighting, and President Erdoğan recently says that finally peace is restored to Cizre. But it's also the case when we're talking about labeling of opposition groups. Now, a former ally of the president, Fethullah Gulen's Islamist movement network fraternity, was once respectedly referred to. Then overnight they became a parallel institution, and when uttered by the president himself, and the entire pro-government media took upon that label overnight. They became the parallel terrorist organization, the parallel organization. So there is this idea of creating new concepts and using them at play and normalizing them. Non-truths and propaganda. Well, we are living in the age of extreme polarization, and social media is, of course, a breeding ground for non-truths and propaganda. This is not only the case in Turkey, but in Turkey at the moment we are facing the case of a pro-government media that is fabricating news in such blatant ways. I'm talking about fabricating interviews, making up facts, doing completely out of place photoshops to images, and then actually announcing them as news in a way that would perhaps make Göring proud or make him embarrassed a little bit. And finally, we really see a sense of leader veneration, the great master, the Sultan, who represents the national will and whose way we have to follow. But importantly, there is, of course, a very important mass mobilization. The leader, through the party, through the state, goes to the masses, either through the party mechanism or through clientelistic networks, what have you. So this is also a hierarchical network with a lot of popular support, a lot of popular backing. Now, those of you who've been listening to me or have probably seen these before might remember, might have a sense of what we're talking about. We're not talking about the Ottoman monarchy. We're talking about something much more relevant, modern. In fact, the top parts, the ones in red, are the same as Umberto Eco's very famous article, Urfascism. There is a fascistic tendency in what is happening in Turkey's modern state. Now, if you're a serious academic, when you hear the word fascism, you take a step back. Because as you know, or you don't have to be an academic, anyone who's serious, but especially academics, because it's a word that is thrown around way too casually, but it has huge implications. So I would like to say that this is a word that I would not really come close to until very recently. And we would know that in left-wing traditions in Turkey as well, saying somebody or the right-wing or the other side is fascist is quite the norm, which dilutes the meaning of the term. But we now increasingly see serious academics doing impartial work on Turkey, sociologists, political scientists, increasingly uttering the word fascism, neo-fascism. Of course, we're not talking about a replica of the interwar era Italian and German fascism. There were specific examples, and we're not talking about a set system that is very compact, but we are talking about an emerging fascistic movement, or not a movement, or a governing style. This is very, very worrying. But I remind you again, this is happening at a time of deep crisis, deep liberal democratic crisis, humanitarian social crisis, complete collapse of the state order in the Middle East, and inward-looking, a period of inward-looking and, in fact, paranoia and complete fear in the European Union. So we have to think about it in those terms. Now, I'd like to... Oh, okay, not too bad. Good, I can have a drink of water. I'd like to very quickly go over the evolution of this regime so as to show you that this was not always the case. And I'm not here to tell you that Turkey has been ruled by a fascistic government for a decade, 15 years. In fact, there is a transition that is in place that is very symbiotic. If we look at the first period of the Justice and Development Party, AKP's rule from 2002 to 2007, at home we see the existence of a liberal Islamist alliance against what were the tutelary institutions of the Kemalist Republic, the secular military and the bureaucracy, and undoing this guardianship structure, aided, of course, and inspired in these liberal economic and political reforms very much by the European Union, which was the anchor, the inspiration, and the institutional locomotive of... does that exist in English? Of Turkey's reform processes. It was a moment of societal openness where all the skeletons in Turkey's closet came out to be discussed in remarkable, candid manner. And it was under the government of the Justice and Development Party. It was, of course, within a framework of a neoliberal growth, which had its significant internal contradictions and problems, but nonetheless, it was a big moment, a liberal moment for Turkey. From 2007 to 2011 comes a different age, a slightly changed time. At home and domestically, we don't really see the pursuit of democratic reforms, but rather a high-stakes power struggle between the guardians of the old regime, the bureaucracy, the judiciary, and the military, and this liberal Islamist alliance. High-level closure cases, cases against suspected coup plotters and what we call the deep state, extra-legal elements within the state that act on behalf of the state from an ultranationalist ideological background and are responsible for a lot of the human rights abuses in Turkey, especially in the 1990s and especially against the Kurds. It is, however, a period of stalled democratization. And when you look, of course, this is also a period when the EU no longer cared about Turkey. It was a period after the referenda shut the doors to Turkey from Merkel to Sarkozy, and the kicking off the economic crisis. High economic growth, despite this, continued in Turkey and made sure that the government, both in its pursuit of power, but also in its delivery of services, was very, very popular. We could call this a period of regime contestation where Turkey moved from a tutelary democracy towards an illiberal democracy. Terms that we use in political science, which are becoming increasingly popular. From 2011 to 2013 was the undoing, unraveling of the liberal Islamist alliance. Once the common enemy, the common foe, the tutelary actors were out of the fray, it became obvious that the worldviews of these two coalitions, constituents of the coalitions were quite different, and those who had the institutional power and the mass backing, the Islamists, would have their say. The liberals realized and started complaining about increasing illiberalism, the destructive neoliberal growth, intolerance in speech, growing nationalist rhetoric and divisiveness, and fell out with the government slowly. It also corresponded with an economic slowdown, of course, which meant that the government's attention was focused increasingly on massive infrastructure projects, construction. Construction became the norm of Turkey. We see, when we go to Istanbul, more than the mosques, cranes. Cranes are the new skyline of Istanbul. Construction is great until you have nothing to breathe, no energy, no oxygen to breathe in. And of course, this descent into illiberalism and authoritarianism was covered, shrouded by the world's interest and the West's excitement about Turkey all of a sudden maybe being a model to the Arab world. Before then, they were afraid that Turkey was going way too east on its own way, no longer a compliant ally of the West. And in fact, Turkey experiences went through its most creative moments of foreign policy independence before the Arab Springs, as under the zero problems with neighbors policy. But with the Arab Spring uprisings, there was something hubristic that kicked in, that Turkey's rulers, Prime Minister Davutoğlu now, who was foreign minister, and President Erdoğan, wanted to take the opportunity to reshape the region in their own image. And hubris, imperial hubris, takes your feet off the ground, makes you unrealistic. That clashed with the previous foreign policy idea of Turkey. I would call this period the period of competitive authoritarianism. The period after 2013 till now is one of extreme social polarization. It started with the Gezi Park protests and then continued, of course, with the split, very destructive and violent split at the head, at the high levels of the state infrastructure of the two Islamist allies, the Gulenists and the Justice and Development Party. That followed purges in the bureaucracy, purges in the security establishment, and restaffing of these institutions by ultranationalists who were erstwhile put under put through an investigation and being taken out of the fray. So in a sense, the closets that were out of Turkey's the skeletons who were out of Turkey's closet went back inside the closet and actually put on their bureaucratic suits. This is the return of what we call the deep state and civil war since the previous summer in the most destructive manner, that in a way that is probably incomparable even to the destruction of the 1990s. And that is, of course, very, very sad. I would say that since June 2015 or July 2015, we're also witnessing the suspension of democracy. Turkey, even at its most difficult moments, had an electoral basis. There would be a faith in the application of the electoral institutions. There would be elections, and the outcome would be respected. But the June outcome, which was not favoring the Justice and Development Party, the first election that the government lost, was effectively cancelled, and the civil war started afterwards. Of course, with the inclusion of the Kurdish fighters, PKK, as well. But since 2015, we're not really able to talk about the existence of even electoral democracy in Turkey. I would call this an unstable state of neo-fascism. Unstable because the future is very uncertain. It is, there is still, unlike, for example, in Putin's Russia, or if we take the interwar fascist regimes, not a conclusion to the power struggles that are happening. They're still very bitter, so we do not know which way they will result in. Erdogan might prevail, putting everyone down, all of his rivals. We don't know what Turkey will look like in that state. Definitely not a very exciting, fun place. The deep state may devour his ally, Erdogan, and we may see the return of the military, bureaucratic, ultranationalistic veneer of Turkey. It might happen. Or the prospect, the possibility of civil war with Turkey's presence, of course, in all the conflicts which it was trying to manipulate, but which are now manipulating it domestically, presents the very real threat of a deepening and spreading further into Turkey. That, of course, is something that is incredibly scary, not only for people from Turkey or the region, but for all of us, because Turkey, once again, is at the intersection of this very, very critical region, which is suffering from two simultaneous crises, the crisis in Europe and the crisis in the Middle East. So the direction that Turkey goes will give us hints about the direction that all of us who are on the same boat will also go. I would like to end by showing, if I can. Did they not come? Ah, okay. The state of the civil war that we already saw from the pictures before. This is not Syria, this is Turkey, but this is very much part of the same war. That war is expanding. And these graffitis that you now see on destructed Kurdish villages from the top left that says Armenian bastards, in reference to, of course, an association with the Kurdish militants who are fighting the Turkish security forces, and the reference that they're actually not Muslims, they're actually Armenians who survived the genocide and are now fighting back. There is an incredible and very, very scary continuous popular and political reference to 1915 with regards to what's happening today, which means that history is still haunting us. Türksen övün, değilsen itaat et. If you're a Turk, be proud. If you're not, obey. To show you the increasing influence of the Salafist movement also among the government's security forces ranks, the graffiti by the Esadullah team, which is an Islamist fighting force employed by the government, actually. But the actual picture, actual tragedy is this. The tragedy does not know ethnicity or religion or background, usually, but it does know socioeconomic class. It's the overwhelmingly the poor, the unprivileged, the disenfranchised. They could be Turkish, they could be Kurdish, secular, devout, who get affected by it. And Turkey is increasingly getting used to these images. It's becoming normalized. It's extremely troubling. And it's troubling not only for those from Turkey, but for all of us here. I'm sorry to leave you with such a down note, but I think we should really think about this a little bit and talk about it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Kara. I think we're still procrastinating on all this information and how you link the domestic policies to the international. So my question, I don't have a broad question, it's a specific question, because this phenomenon deep state is coming back, and maybe it's because I'm not a political scientist, but could you maybe elaborate a little bit more on what is a deep state and what makes it dangerous?
Thank you for asking. I knew that as I'm trying to cover a lot of issues and concepts and time periods, some of the notions that are very familiar to us or those of us from Turkey may not be so for the rest of the audience. The deep state is a bit of a bit of a mystery, bit of an enigma, so to speak. But if you'd like to pin down to it, we could probably say that it is the notion of the existence of an extra legal, extrajudicial, extra political network of operatives within the state structures that act on the basis of some sort of a duty to the state, but from a very ultranationalist point of view, and take action in these times of crises, whether by promoting, you know, provoking for a military coup d'etat or political assassinations. This institution has its roots in the Cold War and, in fact, in Turkey's presence, Turkey's membership in NATO.
And is it stronger than the one ruler, than Erdogan? The deep state? Is it stronger than one?
I don't want to make it as this boogeyman, which is a bit the case, of course, in Turkey, but it is, I think, more of a mentality, and it is a mentality that is very difficult to defeat. And, of course, it's the network that is based upon this mentality. I would say a mentality is less mortal than an individual. So I think there is actually quite a bigger risk of it outliving Erdogan's presence in Turkey.
Yeah. Thank you. We will come back to, by the way, with a panel discussion. You can ask questions in half an hour. Just one question about your presentation. And it's a bridge, you know, to our next conversation. Yesterday, I read in the newspaper that about 1,500 people were accused of insulting the government last year. And by showing us 7 of the 9 points you showed about fascism, aren't you insulting the Turkish government as well?
I mean, the definition of insult, the content of insult is expanding so much that any criticism is now easily being put down as insult. By the way, those figures are for the president himself, not for the government, which is, of course, you know, it represents the personalization of power in Turkey. The interesting thing I would like to point out, of course, is that, again, this is not a novelty in Turkey. Previous to that, for decades, we had very stringent laws that incarcerated people for insulting Turkishness or insulting the founder of the nation, Mustafa Kemal Atatürk. Yeah. So it is, in a sense, a recycling of...
But if I were the Turkish government or the president, you know, comparing with fascist, you know, I would say, you know, this guy is insulting us.
Are you giving somebody a signal?
Okay,
that's good.
Okay, that's good. Okay, let's go to the next conversation.
thank you
very much. Please
very much.
Go back. Okay, thank you again. I wish to have a Skype conversation with journalist Frederike Geerding. She's a journalist from Holland. She's been journalist for over 25 years. And she specializes in reporting on Kurdish women and political issues in Turkey. She was based for 3 years as one of the few, maybe the only journalist in the southeastern city of Diyarbakir. And she's the author of the book The Boys Are Dead, 2014, on the Roboski massacre and the Kurdish question in Turkey. And she was twice arrested in Turkey for allegedly writing terrorist propaganda, and she was banned from the country on September 9, 2015. So let's see if we can...
Hello, Frederik. Do you hear us? It's always tricky with
Hello.
Skype.
Good evening.
Hello, good evening. Welcome.
Yeah, I hear you properly.
Good.
Thank you.
We thought you were in Erbil, but that's not the case. Where are you right now?
Well, I can hardly believe it myself, but I'm in Bulgaria. I'm having my first holiday in, like, I don't know how many years.
Well, we're very sorry to interrupt your holiday, but happy that you're
no,
here.
No, that's fine. That's okay. Fine.
So for the next 15 minutes, we're mostly want to talk with you about the issue of freedom of the press, because that's all over the news. And then my first question is, well, has there ever been actual freedom of the press in Turkey? So what is, can you tell us a bit more about press freedom in Turkey?
Yeah, it's never been free, and I liked what the previous speaker said, like insulting Erdogan. A lot of people get detained for that now and prosecuted, but it's not a new thing. And it's the same with press freedom. Erdogan takes it to new heights, you know, the lack of press freedom, but it's never been there. For example, what you see now in the southeast of Turkey, the destruction of the villages that the previous speaker also spoke about. These things happened also in the 1990s, and nobody really knew about it. Many people were, as refugees going or internally displaced people from the southeast of Turkey, going to western cities, and many Turks actually thought these were economic migrants, but because they had no idea what was actually going on in the southeast. Nowadays, you can know, of course, because of social media, you know, nothing really stays hidden. But at the time, it was the army that really censored the media and said, you know, you cannot go into this territory, you cannot write about this, you cannot, you know, report on this kind of stories. And now it's another mechanism working in Turkish media that is preventing the real stories from getting out.
Frederik, let me ask you a question about the freedom of the press and the independence of the press. To what extent is Turkish press independent? How is that organized? Can you tell us something about that?
Yes, I can tell you something about that. That's really interesting because it's not like an old-fashioned kind of censorship that the state says. Also, that happens, by the way, like you mentioned my book about Roboski massacre, when that happened, end of December 2011, then really Ankara, the government, called big television stations and said, you cannot report about this until it's officially confirmed. But there's another mechanism going on, which makes media, both television channels and many newspapers, like 80% of the newspapers nowadays, totally financially dependent on the government. It works like this. You have, like, if you compare it to the Dutch situation, as if the major newspapers in Holland would be in the hands of Unilever, of a very big company who is also in very many other branches, actively in other branches. So if you have one of the big companies is Doan, and there's other companies as well, if you write against the government, you will, for example, not get wind a bit to help construct the third bridge over the Bosphorus in Istanbul, for example. So these ties are very tight, and you can't really escape that. And there's a few media which are still independent, like Cumhuriyet, which is a very old paper. It was established in 1926, which the editor-in-chief, Can Dündar, also, yeah, he made news. He's a good journalist, so he made a news about Turkish arms transports to Syria, and he's now accused of being a spy, and life sentence is asked against him by the prosecutor. But that's an independent newspaper, and there are a few of that, but like 80% is in a total solid construction with the government, and they can't escape that.
But to go back to press freedom, because then there's a conclusion there never was freedom of the press, but there is, of course, a judicial system. There are laws about press freedom in Turkey, because those two journalists you talked about were just released from prison due to the judicial system. So it must be more complex than there is no freedom of the press in Turkey.
Yeah, of course, I'm also independent. I'm not working for any big company. I'm totally freelance. And I was accused of making propaganda for a terrorist organization. And eventually, I was acquitted. And that also has to do with the European Court of Human Rights. There have been many cases like this in Turkey. And every time the European Court of Human Rights says, Turkey, you cannot do this, this is freedom of speech, whatever somebody writes,
Frederick, we lost you.
Yeah.
Frederick. And the European court is very clear about that. But still, they open such cases against journalists, me and many others. It's an intimidation also, of course. I hear from colleagues in Istanbul that they are a little bit reluctant now to go to report about what we just saw on the pictures, the destruction. They're afraid, like, maybe I'm going into some street where curfew is going on, and what if I don't know it? What if I get arrested? What if they throw me out like Frederica? So it's, you know, in this way they can intimidate people. And also the Turkish law doesn't really help, because, for example, press law and in the constitution it says the press has to be free and there can be no censorship. But then a but follows, and then there's a whole list of things that are excluded from press freedom, and they are usually very vaguely worded, like you cannot go against the unity of the state. Yeah, you know, how can you define such kind of wording? So there's a whole list of things that are also family values. You cannot go against family values. Well, you can, whatever somebody writes fits into the law, like, you know, press is free, but what you did is not free.
Okay,
like, so with Can Dündar from Cumhuriyet, the press is free, but you've been spying, so you will be prosecuted anyway.
Okay, yeah, so then the last question will be from Baran, because unfortunately our connection is a little bit bad. We wanted to try this because we had this connection with a Kurdish fighter in Iraq in the mountains, and it was 10 times better than from Bulgaria, which is really weird. But we are happy that you joined us.
Yeah.
And we,
good for Kurdistan, yeah.
Yeah, good.
So, Frederick,
and, but the last question from Baran, and thank you for joining us.
If I ask you, do we get a good here in Holland or in West Europe, do we get a reasonable good idea about what's going on in Turkey or not?
Well, sometimes yes. If you follow a lot of newspapers, American, English, Dutch, whatever, if you read German, but what you also see now that the conflict is getting bigger again, that there are a lot of, like, what is sometimes called parachute journalists. They come flying in from all over the world and stay for a few days in Diyarbakir, where I lived, or somewhere else in the region, and they quickly make a story, not always with enough background information. And when you know the situation well, it's sometimes, you know, it's too shallow, or they make mistakes that somebody wouldn't make if you know more about the subject. But that's a little bit the risk when a conflict gets out of hand like this, that you have journalists who don't know the situation too well. But there's really good journalists working there too, so.
Well, sorry, I forgot, there's a last question, because our next guest who is in the audience is Kati Piri, and I know you've two met. Maybe you can tell a little bit about your meeting and then end it with a question you have for Kati that we can discuss then here with the audience.
Yeah, I met Kati for the first time last year in Diyarbakir. She came there to check out the situation herself, and I remember showing her around in the city, in the old city. Also, we went to the Armenian church. They have a small restaurant there too. We had dinner there, and after that they showed us the church, the inside, and it's beautifully renovated. But now I have seen, this is exactly the place in the city where all the fighting is going on now. And I saw pictures of the church now, and it's not so, you know, it's not dilapidated or something, but it's really, the structure is damaged. And it must hurt Kati too, I'm sure, and she's been there again recently. But I find it really great that Kati is going there so often, and she really knows, in a short time she has, you know, she has really updated very well her knowledge, also the knowledge of Europe, about of the European Parliament, about what's happening there. But I was wondering if she has the feeling that she can that you can make European Parliament understand what is going on there. Because if you see it with your own eyes, it makes a big impact. And she knows the realities on the ground now. But Europe is so busy, you know, with its fear for her. I'm wondering if she feels she can, you know, make European Parliament understand what is going on in Diyarbakir and in the greater region.
Okay, thank you. We're going to ask that. Thank you, Frederik.
Thank you very much, Frederik. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Okay, thank you.
So we heard the name Kati Piri. Would you please, where is Kati? Would you please join us over there? Yes. Okay. And Karabekir, would you please sit over there? Kati Piri, you're born in Hungary, and as a baby, you came to Holland with your parents in Utrecht. And now you are a member of the European Parliament for the Dutch Labour Party, Partij van de Arbeid, since 2014. And you are here because, mostly because of the, you are the Turkey rapporteur for the European Parliament. You were in Turkey last December in preparation of new progress report on human rights, freedom and press, and the independence of judiciary in the country. You called it perhaps the most critical report on Turkey for the past years. And I wonder, what were your findings in that report, and how did you conduct a report on those issues in a country as our keynote speaker described a little bit, please? How did you do that, and what were the findings?
Well, thank you very much, and good evening. Perhaps it's good to say that in the European Parliament, with every country which is a candidate country of the European Union, we make a political report annually. And then normally there's one person drafting the report, and of course you have the option of making amendments, etc. And every year there's a process of a report. Now, I'm the one who's drafting the initial draft of the report, and of course when it's adopted, it's the opinion of the European Parliment. And I don't think anyone will be surprised when you follow the news, when you just saw the presentation, that when you look over the last years, that I had to write the most critical report over the past years. While we see our European leaders, and I'm happy for that, that for the first time we have a very intensive dialogue with Turkey, but perhaps it's a bit late. And I would have rather seen that there would have been an intensive dialogue before the refugee crisis. Perhaps it wouldn't have had to come even to this point. The main findings of the report, very shortly, are, I think, the topics which were described earlier. Of course, press freedom, the general state of the rule of law, which is really deteriorating. Turkey, instead of moving towards EU membership, it's actually moving away from EU membership. And this is the key issue. The Kurdish question is and what's happening in the southeast, Federico also talked about it. I think there's almost no attention to it compared to the catastrophe which is happening in the region. So I wanted to make sure, if my colleagues agree in the European Parliament, this will be one of the main features of the report. And as a final point, also looking ahead for the coming months, we're talking about this crisis, which has been going on for 40 years. But there's also another conflict where perhaps, in order to give a little bit of light for tonight's debate, there might be a solution coming this year, which is the division of Cyprus. So this is, of course, this could have also a positive impact on the region. Perhaps, if things go well, could even have a positive impact on the accession talks between the EU and Turkey. So I also, of course, in the report wanted to highlight the more optimistic thing. And you see, I forgot the refugee crisis. Of course, the refugee crisis is a part of the report.
Before we go to the refugee crisis, you say there is so much going on in the East and nobody talks about it. You were there, talk about it.
Yeah,
I mean, what's going on?
Well, I think some people in this room know what happened when I only wrote a Facebook message about this 2 weeks ago. I was there 2 weeks ago. So last 10 months, I was three times in the region. First time with Frederike, and I managed to see this beautiful city, Diyarbakir. Second time, it was indeed in December. And now, let me just, you know, not make political statement, but describe you what happened there and what I saw. This is what put me in an awkward position with the government, but it happened already, so I can repeat it here. What I met family members of those people who are inside these cities, which are under a 24-hour, never-ending curfew, at that day already for 80 days. On the 2nd of December, when the curfew started in Diyarbakir, there were still probably around 2,000 people
inside which haven't been able, who haven't been able to exit or enter their houses as of that moment, while all this fighting is going on between the PKK and the military, the paramilitary, the police. What we tried to do there is, with having talks with the governor, who's of course someone representing the AK Party, but I would say a really good man who is also responsible for the citizens living there. We tried to negotiate that there would be a humanitarian corridor for those civilians who are still in Diyarbakir. And this hasn't happened in any of the Kurdish cities under curfew. We actually saw a kind of massacre happening the week earlier in Cizre, where about 150 people in a cellar were burnt alive. There was not, I didn't see in a Dutch newspaper a single article about that. So we knew what could happen in Diyarbakir, and we managed that day to get six people out of this city with the permission of the governor, with the permission, there was a ceasefire of 1.5 hours, with the permission of the army. And one of the women, unfortunately, died on her way to the hospital. And it was very frustrating on the way to be there and think, if we, with a very small delegation, I was there with just 4 or 5 colleagues, could manage this, how much more, I believe, could be done for these people who are still there until the day of today, while the heavy shellings are continuing. This could be so much more happening for these people if there would be some EU pressure. But in the meantime, I see everyone in Brussels is just preparing the summit for Monday. No one dares to speak out loud about what's happening there. And in the meantime, on a daily basis, I get the reports from those people in Diyarbakir, the politicians, the family members of those who are stuck there. And it's very frustrating then to sit here and not being able to really concretely help.
Fred, before we start a panel discussion, I don't know how to put this question without being rude or aggressive to you. But
I'll try. Okay.
You know, because normally these reports, they generally they appear in October. But your report, your critical report, was published in February. And in November, we had this election, which Erdogan won. I can imagine that if your report was published normally, as other reports, in October, that would probably have... Now you are not, you are saying no.
I think
that
you're confusing two reports, but I'll be happy to explain.
Yeah, but it would have a bad implications for the government. So what happened? This, by the way, this was one of your points about thinking in plots, you know, in complot theory.
Yeah.
And one of them.
Well, I'll be happy to explain you how it worked. I'm actually very, you know, the commission who is actually conducting, the bureaucrats who are conducting the negotiations, also make an annual report. And every year it's published in October.
Yeah.
Every year this has been the case since the first day that these reports were published. The parliament, normally we wait for this report. We conduct a work visit to Turkey, which I did in December, and then prepare the parliament's report. For the first time ever, the commission decided to postpone its report twice. First before, because in mid-October, there was suddenly, for the first time, a high-level meeting with Turkey. And a second time it got postponed, because on the 1st of November, there were elections in Turkey, and no one wanted to offend the government. That's clearly what was behind it. And because of that, for the first time, the commission decided to postpone its report. So actually, in the parliament, I can say that among all the political groups, we think this was one of the big mistakes the European Union did and continues to do, being silent about the internal developments in Turkey, just looking with a migration glasses to Turkey and not entering into a real dialogue, while we are at the point where I think we have the most worrying situation in many years in the country.
But yeah, we want to talk now about the influence of the refugee crisis on Turkey and EU relationships. But also a question for you, Kaya, before we, well, we're going to talk about everything that's going so wrong in these. So we saw that Turkey is having 2.5 million refugees, and the Netherlands is 30,000 and crying every day about it. How does Turkey handle 2.5 million refugees? And could they serve as an example, or is there something also that the Europe can learn from Turkey in this way before?
First of all, I'm not an expert on the refugee refugee issue per se, but I have my own, you know, opinions and observations. I'm also glad that the question was brought up, and thank you for clarifying, Kati, because, you know, there were in fact two different reports. I just wanted to say that. And for those of you who are interested in how that development went, I would like to say that the leaked minutes of that high-level meeting between President Erdoğan and the EU bigwigs are online. They were not refuted. And it is a bit of a, if I may just add this before I start answering your question, a bit of a negotiation for a bartering for a carpet in the Grand Bazaar, where it's about the money that Turkey will receive for keeping the refugees. And are we talking about 3 billion? Are we talking about 6 billion? We'll leave the table if you're talking about 6 billion. We can't give one dime more than 3 billion. And it is, you really see that the talk of refugees is like a commodity. There are threats of shipping the refugees across. There are, you know, reassurances from the European side that we actually postponed the report not to piss you off. Why isn't that enough? So, I mean, that really does reveal the face of what's happening at the very high echelons. And thank you for, you know, struggling against it, I should say. And therefore, we should separate the two reports. Turkey has, in fact, dealt with the refugee crisis in a way. It is not as big in the Turkish mainstream discourse, even though it is such a high number of refugees. Now, it is true that Turkey, the Turkish refugee camps are some of the best organized ones in the world. I mean, when you compare the Turkish refugee camps for the Syrians with the jungle in Calais, you really see two different approaches that are very, very, you know, and that is something that Europeans, I think, should take into consideration. But nonetheless, this is a lot of the refugees are unregistered, unaccounted for. The going and passing through the border is quite uncontrolled, and we see that a lot of these explosions that have been happening, the terrorist attacks, have their sources, of course, with the complete breakdown of the order in the borderlands as well. So, and it's changing Turkey's demographic, you know, attitudes, social attitudes towards the demographics, creating some sort of a new backlash against Syrians, I would say, among the Turks. So it comes with a lot of troubles that we're not really talking about because the space for constructive dialogue has ceased to exist in Turkey.
But because the refugees are, of course, are used as a bargain method. But as I said, in the Netherlands, 30,000 refugees already sparks a crisis. How is Turkey thinking of giving shelter to 2.5 million and maybe 3.5 million refugees as a country itself? Is there a whole other debate on refugees than we see here in the West?
I mean, as I said, the debate is a bit, you know, there is not that many healthy debates going on, I would say. But Turkey is a bigger country, of course, than Holland. Let's also put that into consideration. But the proportion is still much bigger of the refugees in Turkey. There are debates about, you know, giving limited working permits. Some of them is happening. They're able to get health care. So I think this is the reality of Turkey now. I mean, a lot of the refugees, and in fact, I mean, if you look at Syria now, how are they going to go back? As it is changing the face of, you know, European demographics in a sense, or European perception of its demographics more than the reality probably, it is also changing facts on the ground in Turkey as well, and its consequences are yet to be seen.
Kati, can we say that Turkey is a safe place for refugees?
Well, this is the big political and legal debate we are having, where you even have to make the distinction, is it safe for Turks or for Kurds, or is it even, you know, is it safe for refugees? Yesterday when I had a meeting with the Turkish ambassador to the EU, he said, why would the EU have to decide whether we are safe or not if all these 2.5 million Syrian refugees decided we are safe?
That's a very
of
good
course,
question.
That's
yeah.
Just to give you the option how the Turkish government looks at it.
Yeah.
I think, let me put it like that, the way Europe is looking at it now is not going to solve the refugee crisis. Just thinking, if Turkey is safe enough, we can, you know, keep all the refugees there, yeah, and we will not have to take our burden. Obviously, this is not something that the Turkish government is happy about, but it's also making Turkish people really angry. I mean, 2.5 million Syrians, we didn't talk about the 400,000 at least registered Afghans and Iraqis, and coming in on a daily basis, 12 cities in Turkey where there are now more refugees than Turkish people. And yes, it's true, it does not come up to the high political level yet, but when you go to a city like Izmir, even on the West Coast, or even if you speak earlier in Diyarbakir on this issue, before, of course, this crisis started, this is something that regular people are talking about, because the prices of rent are going up. It's more difficult to find a job in those areas, especially in the south, where there is already a very high unemployment. So you see that also Turkey is reaching its limits. And that's why it will also need Europe, it will also need the West, in order to find together a solution for this crisis.
So I ask you a very concrete question. Is it a safe place or not for refugees? And you're saying, this is not a good question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sorry, I'm a politician.
That's good, I understand. No, that's good. Because you are emphasizing other stuff than only when we say safe or not, it has implications for, okay, so let's have them over there because it's safe. But then you are ignoring major other problems, as you mentioned. Thank you.
A couple of weeks ago, there were the talks between Merkel and Erdogan on the highest level, and it was framed in the media almost like Europe was selling itself out to Turkey in order to just Turkey to keep the refugees. But now it has been kind of quiet, not real agreements are made, negotiations are going very slow. Could you give us some insight from Brussels, what is going on with the negotiations, and did maybe Turkey, where there are their questions or what they want, was it too, did they ask too much? What's going on right now?
Let me start with what has the European Union done since there was an EU-Turkey summit, apart from having the picture of the Turkish leaders together with the EU leaders, which was very important, I think, for the Turkish government. But then we had a fight for 4 or 5 months. Okay, this 3 billion, but who's paying for it? And this fight only stopped 3 or 4 weeks ago. So finally, we have agreed that we will pay this 3 billion.
Who's we?
We as European Union, right? The 3 billion, which is not meant for the Turkish government, it's meant for refugees in order to make sure that they have better perspectives in Turkey so they don't all take the illegal routes, which are, and dangerous routes, which are there to come to Europe. So did we deliver a single project so far since October on refugees? No, we didn't. Did we open up routes, legal avenues for refugees now in Turkey to come to Europe? No, we didn't. We had many debates about closing off borders. We now have the NATO ships which are going to patrol between Turkey and Greece. We have had many demands for Turkey, which I think are right. But let's not forget that we ourselves have not yet really delivered on any of our promises. What did Turkey do? I think it can do much more. But what did it do, at least so far? It did open up for these 2.5 million Syrian refugees, at least for the working population, many children among them, the possibility to work in Turkey legally with the same minimum wage as for the Turkish people. This is not a popular decision, but they did take it. So I think here the Turkish government deserves to be praised. What they did is stop the secondary movement of Syrians coming from Lebanon and Jordan. So they, until 4 or 5 weeks ago, remained to have an open policy at the Syrian border. Of course, this changed now. But they tried to stop the secondary movement. From human rights perspective, you can have many opinions on it, but I think the EU leaders were very happy with this.
What are the human rights perspectives?
Well, I think that refugees, we as an international community, think we must guarantee that those people in need of protection must get protection.
Okay. I have only one more question before we go to the audience. Correct me if I'm wrong, but during your lecture, you said that this tragedy has no ethnicities, has no religion. The tragedy is going on in Turkey, the killings. But if I look at you and maybe your report, maybe we can say it has ethnicity. It has a religion aspect in it. I don't want to really problematize that issue between you, but I guess if it...
You're trying to make trouble for us.
Yeah, yeah. Would you please, how do you see that, one more time, how do you see that, how do you see it?
I think...
It has no ethnicity, you said.
Well, if I can actually repeat or rephrase what I said, what I wanted to say, and thank you for asking, I wouldn't want there to be a misunderstanding. Of course, there are ethnic and religious elements of what's going on in Turkey, but the suffering, I would like to say, is mostly on the level of... is better understood if we look at the socioeconomic levels. Regardless of what background and ethnicity and religion you come from, if you're better off, your children will not die in this war. It is unlikely that they will also die in one of the attacks. It might be as they become more haphazard. So this is something, in my opinion, that should give us... It is something that cuts across these ethnic and religious divisions. And this is the way conflict occurs everywhere. So, of course, it is very much focused on the Kurdish region and the Kurds now, in an incomprehensibly unbalanced way. And there is the reality of religion and Islamism and its opponents. But that was a point I wanted to make. I don't think I contradicted Kati's...
Of course, I mean, terrorism, Turkey is seeing, again, a resurgence of terrorism of many sorts, actually, which is, of course, of great concern, I believe, to all Turkish citizens. I was in Istanbul before we're going to Diyarbakir 2 weeks ago, and for the first time, I heard many friends saying they are scared. Mm-hmm. They are scared. Mm-hmm. Of course, the most recent ISIS attack, at least ascribed to ISIS, was in happening in Istanbul, which hit German tourists who were there. Then, of course, you had the huge attack in Ankara, which mainly hit trade unionists at
the first
moment.
Yeah.
Yes, the first one. I'm sorry. Yeah, the largest terrorist attack on Turkish soil, which killed more than 100 people. And then, of course, you have on a daily basis what's happening in Kurdish cities. And there I also have to mention, the day I was in Diyarbakir, going to the governor at a moment that 7 of his soldiers were killed this morning, sometimes we also forget about that part. Mm-hmm. And these are probably the same people from the same street, the same Kurdish youth who are now on opposite sides. And for the mothers, it really doesn't matter whether your son died in a uniform or not. So polarization is increasing in the country, and it's many people feel scared also because of the war that's going on in Syria and the effects it can have on their daily life.
They see no end to it.
Well, we will think of last question for the both of you.
Yeah.
We will now go to the audience. Uzuma, maybe you will go with the mic. Please raise your hand if you have a question for one of our speakers, and we really like questions. That means that there is a question mark, so no statements, please.
Only one hand? Okay.
The mic on, please.
You can take the mic.
Again.
I would like to ask to the professor, why did Erdogan pick his moment in July 15 to unleash his forces on the Kurds? was he supported by the army to do that? Was it just for electoral reasons? I think he is opening up quagmire, and he already knew it when it started. So what is his aim for this?
Okay. Great question. Yeah.
So what was why did the war start, or why did Erdogan do what he did after the June elections? There are several dimensions to it, but one very big dimension is, of course, the loss of the then ruling party, AKP, its single government position. And we know from the proceedings inside that President Erdogan was outruled the possibility of a coalition from the very get-go, and some of his closest allies, aides, revealed this. Whereas perhaps we could say that the Prime Minister, Davutoglu, was more genuine in pursuing some sort of a coalition attempt. It would seem that the President's strategy was a very Machiavellian one, to create a state of emergency that would drive the nationalistic fervor in the country up, give the impression that the victory of the pro-Kurdish People's Democracy Party led to this downfall and civil conflict, and thereby both pull those conservative, pious voters who were moving away from the government back to his government with the nationalist fervor, and also the Kurds away from the HDP, the People's Democratic Party. And in a great sense, this happened. This was a very Machiavellian strategy, and it worked, and it was a bloody strategy, let's say. But there's also the flip side to this. The flip side is that the PKK agreed to dance the tango, let's say. They were very quick to also announce that they were abandoning the ceasefire and unleashed some very strategic attacks against Turkish targets. I could say, I come back to this idea of the hierarchy. It looks like, once again, we should not forget that PKK and its heads in not Abdullah Öcalan, who's incarcerated, but those who are in the Kandil Mountains of northern Iraq, also move with the dynamics and strategy of what's going on in Iraq and Syria. So for them, perhaps the victory of the HDP and a democratic a parliamentarian process didn't make much sense. They saw it in terms of a war scenario. So what happened, I would think, in the end, is that as the elephants started trampling, the grass got destroyed. It is indeed, at a very high level, a very vicious power struggle among multiple regional actors in the region. Erdogan is one of them, the PKK is one, another, and there are other ones, of course.
Yeah, question there in the back, and there in the blue shirt.
At the very back, yes.
Please, could you raise your hand again, then?
For question for Kati Piri, what do you think we should ask our government here in the Netherlands to help the people in the cellars in Soer to be prevented from such a massacre as the one that happened in Gisra?
I think what I'm trying to do every day, sometimes public, sometimes, of course, not public, is to indicate that these are not separate issues. I understand that Europe has a strategic interest now to find some sort of solution or start of a solution to the refugee crisis. But we saw last week that the first boats arrived with Kurdish Turks in Greece. We're talking about whether Turkey is a safe country, how can we increase the perspective of refugees in Turkey, while we see that in the southeast, estimates are that 350,000 people had to leave their houses because of these curfews. So I think what we can do is to show that these issues are all linked. So of course the refugee crisis is dominating the news, but you cannot put it aside from what's happening in the southeast, which is also clearly linked to the war in Syria, which is, of course, the biggest reason for this huge inflow of refugees. So raise it wherever you can. I'm certainly trying to do that together with many, many colleagues in the European Parliament. That was also the question of Frederike. I was not the only one in the region. There's almost every week now a delegation of European parliamentarians going there to keep up the pressure. It might not be visible for the media, but we are there in order to hope that we can prevent or help to prevent a type of massacre by showing the international communities there. So ask the Dutch parliament, ask your representatives to, for instance, launch a mission to go there, write about it, ask parliamentary questions, And to make sure that when there is again Monday a high-level meeting with the Turkish government, that we're not just talking about how many people are arriving on the Greek islands on a daily basis, but also look at the causes of this crisis and the future possible crisis coming ahead.
Yeah, over there.
There's also first a guy in the blue shirt and
yeah,
the white shirt.
Yeah.
Why don't you give
yeah. Yep. Yeah, so hold the microphone fast.
Maybe you can give the microphone.
No, we never
no.
give the microphone. It's our golden rule. No.
That's rule number one.
Yeah.
Huh?
Okay.
Yeah.
Especially about this issue.
We are no. so happy with this thing, so they cannot take it away.
I have a question for Mr. Akkoyunlu. Thank you for the great lecture. It's really interesting, first of all. I have a bit of a hypothetical question, and I know academics are not keen on answering that kind of question, but you're a historian, so probably you love it. I have a historical question, of course, and I want to look back at Turkish history, particularly the First and Second World War. How do you think, in what kind of situation would Turkey be now if it would be like its war allies, Italy, Germany, and Japan, who witnessed a significant defeat by the hands of the allies? And who are culturally, politically, and economically much more developed than Turkey is. Is that something which you think if Turkey underwent a total destruction as Germany did, for example, and the trauma it caused, would it be in a different situation now with stronger public institutions than it has now, for example?
Okay. Mm-hmm. Great question, historians. It's only partly one. Love hypothetical scenarios. The fact that Turkey won, first lost, then won the First World War, and then didn't join the Second World War, which I think was a great strategic genius that prevented the loss of many, many lives, a total destruction, perhaps even, as you said, that befell on a lot of sides who took part in the war, also had perhaps the consequence of the fact that some of its foundational taboos, which we still see that are still with us, didn't have to be confronted. Now, I would like to be very careful to make sure that you understand. I'm not saying I wish Turkey joined the Second World War. No, not at all. I think it was a great thing that it didn't. But we see that Germany had to face its demons, mainly because, or only because, it lost the war. I mean, had Germany won the war, it would have not have the same discourse and rhetoric about the Holocaust, and nor would the rest of the world. Turkey, of course, has a different place in history, but it has also very deep skeletons in its closet that it didn't really need to face until perhaps the 1990s and the 2000s, and that opportunity was unfortunately missed in the end. I don't
Could
think we
you
have
elaborate?
Time.
Sir, we don't have the time. Maybe at the bar.
2 minutes to ten.
If you would like, we can talk about it afterwards.
Okay, yes. Great. Yeah.
And so the last question is for you.
And so the first.
Well, I feel very honored to ask the last question of the night.
Okay.
I actually, if you would allow me, I have two brief questions. My first question is as an historian, and my second question is as a concerned world citizen. My first question as an historian actually takes me back to your story to the Sultan days, that you thought that the analogy of Erdogan being a Sultan is wrong, partially because back in the Sultan days, the Sultan actually granted liberties to local leaders to do whatever they want, and pretty much like, well, you know, but obviously, like, as an historian, I think that's more sort of like a pragmatic thing, because of course they couldn't impose their beliefs on their entire empire stretching from Morocco to Kosovo, basically.
You have to go to a question.
Okay, and my second question, as a concerned citizen, and I am, and my dad took me here actually, and we have been talking about this a lot, and that's the only thing that I thought that was missing about tonight, and that is the war, like the warmongering rhetoric against Kurds, and is escalation of the war against the Kurds, Is that not a sheer distraction of the criminal activities of Erdogan and his family, e.g. the illegal oil business that has been going on with jihadist groups such as ISIS? So I would like your opinion on that, actually, both of you.
Thank you.
For the next 20 minutes, right?
Yeah, moeten we een hotel boeken vanavond? Voor?
Well, I think the second question was... of course, there are always links, but I wouldn't say... I think it's much more linked to the defeat of AK Party in June. Of course, I think the wish of the president to have this presidential system, which, to be honest, I cannot understand exactly why this is so important. If you already, in my view, have a lot of power, so what more is there? But perhaps there is a link there with the corruption cases, of course. I think where you see a clear distinction, I don't think you mentioned it in your overview, but of course the 2013 December corruption scandal, that was a turning point, at least to me as an outsider, not living in Turkey, where you started to see, well, this might really be a turn, we are going into a different direction now in Turkey. And I'll be very honest, in June, I think many people again thought that we can go back in another direction. You know, majority of the people did not vote for AK Party, but also wanted to indicate, I think, with that they do not want this presidential system. For the first time, the pro-Kurdish party passed this incredibly high 10% threshold and came in with 80 deputies. You know, this could have been the start of a really new setting where you can have peace talks in the parliament with parliamentarians discussing it. It's so in that respect, perhaps my only kind of hope for the coming months is that I have seen in this short period that I'm responsible in the parliament for Turkey already so many shifts in just a couple of months that I just wouldn't know where we are standing again in 6 months. But I think that's also true for Europe, to be honest. So I don't think the Kurdish question is really linked to just, hiding the corruption scandal. Of course, it's linked to the Syria crisis.
It's not only corruption, I think it's Sorry, wait.
We moeten het echt afronden. Het is echt 3:10.
Yeah, but we're gonna make. Let me because
all right.
Also.
All right, just one more point, please. Just one more point. Just like the reason why Erdogan and Gulen split is obviously because Gulen didn't like Erdogan's criminal activities and was strongly opposed to that.
I'm not sure if that's the reason
also not
of the
sure
split.
That is the reason.
But it means you have a very positive outlook on the Gulen group. So yeah. It's. No. That's it.
If I may, I would only add to the second question to what Kati said, that there is definitely a personal element in general in the creation of this sort of national state of emergency, because I mean the whole edifice is built upon, the one man, and then goes down to the entire nation. If the man collapses, the nation collapses. So it becomes also a convenient way of looking at it. Everything is connected. But let me also emphasize, this is something that is slightly, is yet to be noticed, but I've tried to underline it. The return of the militaristic institutions and traditions of Turkey probably also propel the government towards the old policies, and especially at the time when the Syrian Kurds are making amazing advances, the idea that the fear of separation from Turkey, from this militaristic, military bureaucratic establishment, let's say, that might still be there, and coming back with the new allies of Erdogan, that impulse is also coming back as well. So it's always more than just one causal factor, and in this case, we are dealing, unfortunately, with a horrible perfect storm, it would seem.
Well, I really think we should make more reports about Turkey, because there are already lots of other subjects. I'm thankful you kind of demystified the whole new sultan thing. Of course, I was already thinking of a new word. I was like, maybe he's the new principe, like the Machiavellian prince. Maybe that's a better...
That's a good one.
Yeah, that's a better metaphor. Yeah, well, we found a new metaphor for Erdogan tonight. We have to close it down. I really want to thank Karabekir Akkoyunlu and Kati Piri, and of course the cast of the opera. Big round of applause. And I really hope to see you on April 11, because if there's one country that's never in the news, it's Yemen. And we're going to talk about what's going on in Yemen, also in regional perspective. So I hope to see you there. Have a good evening.
Thank you very much.